Thanks, Andy. Thanks so much for having me. It's really good to be here. I'll read a couple of new ones. I feel like I don't really know what I'm doing in life and in poetry. And this is the first poem that I wrote in quite a while, a few months ago, after feeling fairly blank. And it's about lofts or attics, and it's called Attic Poem. I love attics because it's the closest you can get to being backstage in your own life. The change of air between the mortal world and this. I love the stuffy attic and the cool. I would rather take a tour of attics than a holiday. Oh, vinyl, board games, war chests, sepia. Oh, trauma, obsolescence, broken things. Standing in the wings, I look for some foreshadowing of you. A photograph of us before we met on opposite sides of a park. Your initials in two lost Scrabble tiles. If you dream of an attic, it means there is an afterlife. If you dream of a basement, there is not. Where does that go after a loft conversion? We experience over 7 million thoughts a day. My neighbor is a ballet dancer who maintains he can always tell when someone has a secret. The brain is visibly, manifestly overstuffed. They have a fourth bedroom and ensuite. Where do you put everything you simply don't know what to do with? This is called Italicize This, and it's a love poem. This is a story about a geyser of untranslatable thoughts, but it starts with a Rat Pack B-side called If You Can't Translate a River, How Are You Gonna Translate the Sea? And from there things get worse, which is to say worse in two sets of inverted commas, and the protagonist is a man who forgets all of his body parts, so he has labels attached to all of his body parts, and labels attached to the labels which remind him what labels are and why he needs them, and a tertiary set of labels with conveyance. Do the children run for him from him as he rustles by, or do they point and laugh? Let's be honest. Nobody points and laughs. If I saw someone pointing and laughing in real life, I would point and laugh at them. I remember at the age of 6, I was trying to write the word treasure, and I asked my teacher, how do you spell je? And she said, it's entirely dependent on context. And I said, what's context? You know when you accidentally hug somebody too hard or for too long, and there's a moment where they struggle or they say, oof. What is it that you're trying to do exactly? On my shelf, I have a copy of a journal from the 1980s called Poetic Comment. Only, if you look at it, it's just poems, and they're not great either. There is no comment whatsoever in Poetic Comment. Go figure. Go tell it on the mountain. If I tried to italicize the way I feel about you, the letters would lean so far to the right they'd be invisible. Some from Kane. This is it's sort of a narrative sequence, as far as poetry can do that. In fact, it gives you kind of the license when you're writing the form of poetry, you're writing something that's a kind of ongoing story, and that because it's poetry, you can go from tangents and depart from the plot quite a bit. But I probably will inflict some of the anagrams on you in a minute. But I'll read some from the first section. First, which basically is the plot that I have sort of ruined my life in some way. I've lost my job and abandoned my family and lost my faith. And this has been taken variously as autobiographical or as fantasy, neither of which are true. Or it's both, I don't know. I'll probably read certain stanzas from some of the poems. I'll just try and sort of walk through a few in one movement, but the basic idea is that Cain, or the sort of living embodiment of Cain, one of the ideas in the sort of the midrashic interpretation of Cain's punishment is that he's made immortal, so that he has to witness generation upon generation of trouble and tribulation that humanity inflicts, and that this is part of what happens to him, almost kind of vampiric thing, and that he turns up at my house to try to sort my life out as a sort of therapist stroke life coach. I'll read the first stanza of this one, although it's quite a long poem, and then I'll kind of carry on from there. It's called Strangest Disaster. When I lost my faith and my marriage in the same week, my friends said, "That's okay, we never believed in the construct of romantic love, the redundant institution of marriage, and the state-sponsored mental self-abuse of religion anyway. Welcome to the 21st century, arsehole." This was called No Way to Come Back, I want to tell you about. This distributed denial of service attack on my heart, this giant gravel bag, this constant gentle renunciation of love, this rain on the cliff face, this roll of the eyes, this instant decaf, this dead pigeon. I was going to write a poem for every single one of those, but ended up just doing one. For the first line, this DDoS attack on my heart, or distributed denial of service, which, if you know anything about the internet, which I generally don't actually, is a way of destroying a corporation or company's website. And there's a fairly clear dictionary definition of it, which doubles up as a really good love poem. This DDoS attack on my heart. One common method of attack involves saturating the target mechanism with external communications requests, so much so that it cannot respond to legitimate traffic or responds so slowly as to be rendered essentially unavailable. Enter Kane. The doorbell sounds its own eager quiz. An actual size inflatable Frankenstein's monster is propped up on my doorstep. I have a pin in my hand, so I stick it in. Blam. Behind it stands Kane, his beard blocking out the sun. "How did you know I'd have a pin?"
"I thought you'd either be hovering over a world map or taking up the hem of your trousers," says Kane. "Which was it?"
"I was removing a photo of my ex-wife from the kitchen notice board," I tell him.
"Ah," says Kane. "The trouble is you have to live with every decision you make."
He presents his papers. "This is Kane. Everyone is very concerned about you. We have sent him to make sure you don't do anything stupid." "Stupid?" I ask him.
"That's probably a typo," Kane says. "It's probably meant to say stupid."
Artificial signs.
"While I'm here, it's probably best that I get to know you," Kane says. "We'll talk about some formative experiences, your fears, frustrations, memories, blocks. Might even get a poem out of it, eh?"
Fuck off. The supermarket's logo is resplendent in the twilight. When I scan the first bottle, the automated checkout says, "Approval needed." And Kane says, "She really gets you." Balcony. "Listen, as a child, I thought of being a soldier in the devil's army, vanquished in the last battle, ceasing to exist and then nothing forever. I would lie there, age 11, thinking about this. An angel killed me, and then there was nothing. No dark or light element to silently float in. No element, no floating, no subject or object, no soft barometer to register the nothing. No critics of the neither abject nor beautiful nothing. Like fastening a necklace you aren't wearing. Like trying to soothe a looped recording of a crying baby. Like lighting a fire with the wood you chopped in a computer game. But if I concentrated, I could feel it even so, before I knew the words infinity or oblivion. It does not end nor begin. There is no outside of it, or if there is, that is where we are now briefly perched. We play with toy cars or lounge about smoking on a very privileged loggia. And then I thought I am lucky to have put away such unforgiving fantasies. But then I thought, but now, for a certainty, this is the only balcony." Part of the process of writing the Kane poems involved reading every kind of fictional, mythical representation of Kane as a figure. One of those was Hermann Hesse's last novel, Demian, which has a terrible ending, as most novels do, including mine. Most novels don't know how to end. It has a brilliant first half, which is set at school and concerns a sort of oversensitive child at school and somebody who befriends him, who is a sort of Kane-like figure, or is part of this cult that worships Kane. It was one of about 12 novels that mentioned Kane in some way that I forced myself to read. But it kind of gave me a sort of way into writing some school poems, which are fairly autobiographical. I think I'll leave a long one about trying to play football. Maybe I will. I'll do that and I'll go into the undergrads. This first one's called Self-Portrait at Primary School. "At the age of 8, I was so obliging that I let the weirdest, smelliest kid pick on me because I thought it might make him feel better. He smelled like an open can of soup. They called him the Weirdo. Instead of the red sweatshirt with the school logo on the right breast, he had a generic red jumper which wasn't even the right shade of red. I remember the grain of the wood on the prefab classroom's base against my scalp as the weirdo gently then firmly rolled my head against him. I remember the rolling turn to knocking a tuft of my hair in his fist. And I didn't say, don't do that because that hurts me, because I didn't want to hurt his feelings. I remember smiling quizzically at him, and he beamed back, delighted with his human doll. This relationship continued for a week until a dinner lady marched us both to my teacher. The weirdo was sent for counselling and never allowed to go near me again. And even at the time, it struck me that maybe I was the dangerous one. It's partly a book about television, I suppose, and partly about the therapeutic, or perhaps non-therapeutic way that we use television and sort of long box sets. The 31 anagrams, which I'll just read a couple of at the end, purport to be individual episodes of a 31-episode cancelled, over-ambitious TV show, which Kane and me as the narrator get sort of obsessed with. Before this, we have a sort of terrible habit of watching too much television anyway. So I'll read a couple of kind of TV poems as a lead-in to the anagrams. The anagrams themselves are all of the same passage, which is Genesis 4, verses 9 to 12. And this is a passage of about 150 letters, which contains 42 E's, which is very useful because E comes up a lot, generally, in language. But there are also 41 H's. And H comes up slightly less frequently. It was the King James version I forced myself to use as the source. So I had a lot of H's to dispose of in writing them. And the rules are obviously that you have to use every letter in exactly the same frequency, since it becomes literally the raw material of the text that you go on to create. It has to be every single letter. Obviously punctuation and spaces and things like that are for grabs. That would be ludicrous to try to use the same punctuation. But it has to be every letter. So all of these are exactly the same 150 letters. I'm already kind of forgetting why I set out on it really as a project in the first place. It's partly that there is a sort of Hebraic tradition of the anagram. In the original Hebrew Bible, there are several verses which are actually anagrams of each other, and it's just deliberately this composition. The verse from Exodus, a garland instead of ashes, is an anagram of he has taken away my birthright and my blessing, and this kind of continues throughout the first five chapters of the Bible as a kind of weird form. It was popular in Jewish poetry at the time as well, in the sort of Arabic epoch, pre the birth of Muhammad. And they would make amulets with letters on them that could be rearranged, and the amulet could mean certain things at different times. So it had some kind of tradition to draw. Also, as well, I think using it to try to create a fictional TV show, it struck me that a lot of TV shows, even quite good TV shows, particularly sitcoms, are almost as formulaic. They have their kind of three plot strands that go through every episode. They have the same characters every week. It's almost a kind of cartoon thing. Whatever happens to the characters in one episode, they kind of come back and pretty much the same in the next one. You're kind of shuffling the cards in a way when you're writing something like that. I'll do this one, which is a poem about not really understanding why zombies have become so popular. So the poem called Zombies. When I regain consciousness, everybody is big into zombies. They are playing zombie games and watching big-budget remakes of zombie films. They dress up as zombies and spend half the day in special effects getting made up to look more like zombies. They go on zombie team-building exercises. They have zombie-themed weddings and read zombie comic books and watch many episodes of high-quality zombie dramas. It's like I've died and gone to stupid. What's the deal with zombies? I ask a man dressed as a zombie in one of many Ask a Zombie booths which have popped up on the high street. We're having a zombie moment, he tells me. Well, clearly zombies have tapped into some key part of the collective unconscious which I lack, because I do not give a flying fuck about zombies, I tell him. Easy there, buddy, he tells me. You looked at yourself recently. It's called Television Knows No Night. I think is a Baudrillard quote, but there's no copyright on titles, so you can just steal anything. O open window, O immobility of nature, O spectacle of emotional magniloquence, O error about life entirely necessary, O Miltonic angels of the subchannel, O aspect ratio, I love you but would fade away, O bitrate of energy and spirit, O copyrighted catastrophic legions, I found myself praying for you. I forgot your 20 writers and set designers, forgot your lines and excellent lighting, I forgot the dozen critics and the blogs, the pre-release, the torrent, DTT, I wanted you to be more real than me. Around the anagrams, these sort of very small red sentences which explain the plot, which explain some of the more obscure words which I was forced to use because having this sort of limited letters and needing right anagrams meant that I needed to use really strange words like holothurian, for instance, which is the genus of the sea cucumber. So to move in a holothurian way would be to sort of bob disconsolately along the bottom of an ocean. And that needed defining, because nobody's going to bother to look up holothurian in a large dictionary that even contains that word. And I didn't want to do footnotes, because I felt as if footnotes had been done too many times before. So I went for this kind of weird donut of notes around each little square anagrams. I'll just finish on a few of these, they're fairly brief. I'll read the original little passage from Genesis, which is the bit where God curses the earth after discovering that Cain has killed his brother, and then I'll just do three or four of these. And the Lord said unto Cain, Where is Abel thy brother? And he said, I know not, am I my brother's keeper? And he said, What hast thou done? The voice of thy brother's blood crieth unto me from the ground. And now art thou cursed from the earth, which hath opened her mouth to receive thy brother's blood from my hand. When thou tillest the ground, it shall not henceforth yield unto thee her strength. A fugitive and a vagabond shalt thou be in the earth. Okay, so these are fairly impressionistic, but I want you to bear in mind that they're all exact anagrams of that passage that I just read out, okay? Okay, right, good. And there are three characters, sorry, in the TV show I just read, which is Cain, Father Cain, who is kind of my equivalent of Beren's Henry, and Ada, who is, in Byron's play, Cain is Cain's sister, also a partner. And in this becomes sort of the one female character over whom Father Cain kind of competes for the attentions of. Episode 1. Cain and Father Cain share a property, a hutch in a suburb of bachelorhood, overhung a cheesecloth shoehorned with mutton and things reabbreviated, the hairy household mythologist and his adherent undertone. Ornamentation, a hat, a bunch of rhododendrons, the diadem, the width of a yacht. On the 17th endowment, don't try to thwart a stomach buffet on this, the trillionth interlude. The buttonhook will have his thread, the drogue, a logorrhea. Episode 3. Doorbell. It is Ada in Burberry, bathed in hall light. Ada, rosebud torturer, co-author of Overset Thermometers. Ada, outshining hydrogen trinketry. Soothe their wrathful orphanhood, then come hither nutrient. Ada, heavyweight statuette, handbook for flesh data and VAT theft. The lighthouse den where redemption inducts honey. Ada, brunette attention deficit disorder, old mouthwash. Ada, tetchy demon and conventional French woman. Death, wishbone, horseshoe. Ada regards me coldly. Ditto, bitch, she says. Episode 5. We enroll at HRH Ethelred University at Ada's behest. Cain signs up for 10 evening modules. 1. Arsehole theory. 2. Misunderstanding 101. 3. Heartburn studies. 4. The novelette. 5. Troubleshooting the poisoned. 6. The modern underachiever. 7. Draw in H2H, 3H, 4H, 5H, 6H, 7H, 8H, and 9H, and we're about that. Got rid of 9Hs, which was quite necessary. Often I'd get 73% through an anagram and realise there were still 21Hs left to use. So I had to somebody laugh quite a lot, or sigh, or name pencils. 9. Footnote clutter, 10. Not safe for work. Father K studied doubt, Hebrew, batholiths, bird orthography, to deflower the footpath and ha-ha, cottonmouth, nonconformity, and downloaded hoodoo. Ada signs up for merely threat and bayoneting. I'll just read a couple more. The story of the TV show, such as it is that they share a flat in this disputed territory, kind of balkanized country that's undergoing some kind of intestine conflict. They end up running for their lives, and in a kind of escape fantasy, they go back to their country and wrest control from the general that's seized power. And this turns out to be a kind of something they're imagining while they're actually just dying of dehydration in a sort of makeshift prison. It's quite a miserable sitcom, really, all things considered. I'll read this one, which is when they're attempting to escape, and then I'll just read the final one, which is in the form of a kind of prayer, which I suppose I wrote as an apology for the whole project. But thank you very much for listening. It's been lovely to read to you. Sorry, I'm slightly croaky. So episode 20 and 31. There are various significances of the number 31, which I can talk to you about afterwards if you're so inclined to do that. Episode 20. Ada says she knows a guy who'll smuggle them through the toll booth with all corroborant shibboleths and documentation. It transpires that he's a fat, unwholesome, revenant cherub. His dented Honda hollows their overdraft. 13 officers patrol the border. Their ode to contraband hit short. Hey, David, over here. The 100th hunted benefit, the modernist itinerant, they push the seeded boundary of what it means to emigrate. Why look, the country has a hernia. Verse 1, Father K leads us in prayer. Oh, that thou teach even me, I who abhor truth, the stubborn bloodhound, worth 3 hairbrushes, if that. No, worth hydrogenated fats. No, worth enhanced formaldehyde. What shorthand thunderbolt could halt my hibernation and dog thirsts? The unabridged refrigerator, the unnoted chessboard. Shortlist me with the redundant heathen, half my covenant with toothache. Foot the noun, whatever it takes. Lord have mercy, Gospodi pomilu, Kyrie eleison, Amen.